Let us think Jesus is the Christ, and we'll welcome Professor Dongkyu Kim.
Can someone?
Yeah, I'll share.
Thank you. Professor Dongkyu Kim.
Hi everyone. Thanks for inviting us. Let us introduce ourselves a little bit. So my name is Dongkyu Kim. I'm an assistant professor of political science at the University of Texas, Rio Grande Valley. And here he is.
Hi. I am Mi-sun Kim, also an assistant professor in the same department, political science, and at the same institution.
Okay, so again, thank you so much for inviting us. Let us share the screen. Oops. Okay, I think, but we don't have much time. Is that like how long can we go, Jay?
We could. The remnant day starts at 10:30, and I think like 10 o'clock, and then we'll have like a Q&A time, forum time after that, after 10 o'clock.
After 10 o'clock, so that's okay. Okay, we'll try to keep it short. Okay, we put the title on November elections, which is next week, and prayer for the nation. So watching over this presidential campaign, I think it is really hard to put into a couple of sentences. It is so contentious, too much information, too much debate. But we will try to, share our way to looking at the politics with a couple of points. So let me share quickly some debate points in this campaign. I think probably you know this better than me. On the blue side, we have Biden, and on the red side, we have Trump. Right. And then by making this list, I felt it is really difficult to put into some these debates into some neutral words, because by the time we just cram all the arguments into a couple of words, it looks really, I don't know, contentious, right? So from the top to the bottom, we can compare quickly in terms of economy in the pandemics, right? So Biden is mostly about a cautious opening of the economy. We need to cope with the virus first, and then we have to carefully open up the economy. But on the red side is more about the economy. We have to quickly open it up. And then the White House, like a couple of days ago, they tried to say the pandemic is over already. And then they put more emphasis on the economic recovery. And when it comes to taxing, the blue side is more about collecting more taxes from the rich people. But on the red side, no, rich people is the source of economic growth. We have to keep the 2017 tax reforms to lower the tax burdens for the rich. On the blue side, it says we need to pay workers more by increasing the minimum wage up to $15. When it comes to China, on the red side, the White House tries to blame everything on China. We need to protect our economy. We have to cut off the relationship with China. US companies should avoid offshoring. They encourage inshoring to bring jobs back to the US. On the blue side, it's completely the opposite argument has been made. Trade war with China is harmful to the economy. We have to have a better relationship with China. When it comes to criminal justice, it is more about on the blue side is about we have to address the racial injustice by reforming the police nationwide. But on the red side, no reforms is much more about the order and the law. More instead of saying the Black Lives Matter, on the red side it says Blue Lives Matter for the officers, for the public servants. Their lives matter more, something like that. And then on the immigration issues, blue side is more about pro-immigration, to welcome more refugees from the Latin American countries, from the rest of the world. On the red side, it's more about anti-immigration, especially this word, if I put it anti-immigration, it might upset some Republicans, but if you're actually looking at their foreign policy about immigrations, restrictions has been imposed a lot, especially in our region. We are in the border area where from the border to up to 10 miles, it's like we have a checkpoint. So 30 miles. So when people come to into our region, they don't check. But when you leave this region, they check your passport, right? We have an interior checkpoint. In this region, I heard for about a couple of years, all the visa, the passport vision has been stopped, right? For these citizens here, in order to reprocess their passport, it takes about 2 years or 3 years right now. So it's really against immigration. It's just brief comparison. And as the election approaches by next week, you can see at the national level, right now, the blue team is leading about like 9%. So basically, because the US has an electoral college system, we still pretty much don't know who will be the next president. So let's see. So in understanding in this debate, we want to share our approach to understand the politics in three different angles. I will cover the first one, the ideological divide in the US and how to understand this. And Dr. Kim, Lisa Kim will also talk about how interest groups plays the role and how the media works in these presidential elections. So when it comes to political ideologies, all this debate, right, I just briefly explained, is really difficult to put into two little boxes. But it comes to all the debates comes down to left versus right kind of argument. And what I want to emphasize here, I'm not here to say in front of you to say one party is better than the other party. What I want to share is if we look at the roots of this ideological debate, we can directly see the Genesis 3:6-11 is there. So if we go back to the period where our founding fathers established all the political systems for the US, and we see there's a big grand political debate there, right? In the 19th century, those founding fathers, they loved those debates, like a classical debate in political science. So if you think about the democratic nations in history, and all the debates begin to unfold in front of people, basically by the time the Christendom destroyed, right, at the end of the Middle Age. So in the people's mind, more the political elite's mind, God does not exist anymore. Right. For about 1,000 years, God had provided the legitimacy, the stability, the order to the society. And that one disappeared all of a sudden. And then the big question to the political science minders, philosophers, was like, without the God in place, how can we establish the order in our society? How can we peacefully live and set up a government for the nation? And the founding fathers, they all loved the liberalism on the left side. Well, when there is no God that provides the legitimacy of the government, and what they believe is the individuals, right? Their slogan was basically, individuals are the master of their faith, right? There's no other person who can direct me. I am the sole, the root of the legitimacy of my doing, right? That becomes the mainstream of US politics, even today, right? It feeds the Republican parties, basically. When it comes to whatever topics, it comes down to that one argument. Yeah, so governments that governs the least is the best. Then the question becomes for the liberal founding fathers is this, why do we need a government in the first place then, right? Why do we need it? So in their understanding, we need a government just to protect the property, right? To protect the assets. That's the only thing why we need the government. Other than that, they don't need the government. Lower tax. And when it comes to the facial mask, right? That's the debate on the facial mask is really absurd, but it follows the liberalism tradition. I want to wear the mask. I don't want to wear the mask. Government, you have no place in my life. I don't want to wear the mask. End of the debate, right? On the other side, some founding father believed the republicanism. It is not the individual, but up to society. In order to establish the peace and order, what we need is not the individual's freedom, but more public spirit, more solidarity, fraternities, the love of our country, patriotisms, all sorts of some cultural or spiritual things. But eventually liberalism took over the country, and then, but at the bottom of all the debates, this tension still exists. So in the Democratic Party and Republican Party debate, right, this tension still exists on the gun, on the tax, on the mask, on everything, right? Individual liberty, Republican Party, right? Please don't touch anything else other than protecting the property. Right. So by granting the maximum liberty to individuals, we can make our society better and good. That's a better society. On the democratic side, that's a very, very bad way to govern the society. What we need is the public education. What we need is the welfare programs. So people can live their lives with a public assistant. And small government is actually harmful to help other people to have to live together, to build a strong, lovely society. So in terms of all the LGBTQs, the pro-choice, the gender equality, all these matters comes down to the Democratic Party side. So what I wanna share is like either side, when it comes to which one do I have to support, right? Each one has their own merits. It is extremely difficult to say one is better than the other, but remember this, regardless of your choice, this theoretical debate that undergirds this party debate is anti-God, right? The anti-democratic principle is beneath the surface. That's what I want to share. So because the presidential election is based on electoral college, so some states we know it's blue, and then some other states are red already. So yesterday, Kamala Harris, the vice president nominee, she visited our university, but that's very rare. Because usually Democratic candidates, they do not visit Texas because Texas is a red state. There is no merit. They usually visit the California or the upper Northeast side.
Right? Or it is because based on the popular vote, and the method that we use to divide or allocate electoral college votes to each state is based on winner take all. So based on the population vote and the winner of the popular vote receives all the electoral college votes that are allocated to each state. So there's no merit that candidates or strategic candidates or political parties would visit to any of these solid red or solid blue states because the outcome is already predetermined. So they don't have to really come and spend their time and resources. But interestingly, you know, the Democratic Party candidate came to Texas because, right, it is almost very obvious that it is going to choose also the Republican Party again, right? But I don't know, right? For some reason, this candidate visit, which is very rare. And the red states, as you see, are Republican states, and therefore they have this strong trust and belief in liberalism as a philosophical foundation. And also the blue states, liberal. So they strongly believe in more, I don't know. Yeah, more strongly believe in the Republican philosophical foundation. And here the gray areas, you see those states are called the swing states. And usually candidates spend most of their time and resources in those swing states because, as its name suggests, there's always a chance that the candidates might win all these, you know, electoral college votes. So that's why the media also pay more attention to those states like Florida. They talk a lot about Florida, and the opinion polls in these regions matter a lot because these are the game changers. Even though Texas and California, even though their share in the election is huge, but still not strategic at all.
Okay. Yeah. Still have time.
Okay. So the first part, the ideological division, we want to pay attention to this division because that is the standard that we can use and the frame that we can use to understand politics, not only in America, but also all other democratic countries. So that is the fundamental, I think, the fundamental frame that we can use to understand all the debates and the candidates and their positions and why they say what they are saying, right? It is very helpful. And the second aspect is, you know, the role of interest groups. And here the interest groups could take lots of different forms. Some groups, very politically influential groups, they are economic interest groups. So business, you know, corporations and labor unions and all these, you know, economic interest related groups who, of course, whose main goal is to influence policies that affect their own group's benefits. And it is not just that, but other interest groups, very active and politically influential interest groups, could be equal opportunity interest groups. For example, racial justice, you know, immigrant rights, human rights, all these kind of stuff. And also there are some groups who pursue public interests, so consumer rights and things like that. So there are various types of interest groups, but these interest groups are very active in American politics. It is related to the philosophical foundation, which is liberalism. It emphasizes your political liberty. In other words, your First Amendment rights, freedom of speech. And interest groups are allowed to spend a lot of money, and they can influence elections and campaigns. And it is okay, it is justified, particularly in the American system, because that is their political, you know, freedom of speech, right? So here, particularly in America, the influence of interest groups is huge. And here, there is a way that three organizations, particularly, they can have tremendous amount of influence in American politics through these interest group activities. So that is the point we want to make here. So why do we care about interest groups? Yes, because they are very, very directly and indirectly involved in the electioneering activities. And how? By making lots of advertisement materials and by holding interesting, you know, political events and rallies, and through which they can mobilize voters and they can also educate the public. So positively speaking, educate the public, but negatively manipulating public opinion and how we evaluate candidates and policy issues. So that is, there's a danger there. The three organizations, since they have a lot of resources, they can actively mobilize and they can actively, you know, mobilize their support and utilize their resources, and they can more effectively, you know, achieve their political, you know, agendas behind the scenes. So that is the danger there. And how the issues are framed in the media, of course, we see that there's some kind of influence, you know, going on there. Who frames that particular issue in a particular way so that we can have a positive or a negative view on this, right? So we should be very careful about, we should be very careful when we are to evaluate the events and the things that are going on out there. So for example, political action committees are politicized interest groups that are committed to raising funds for elections and campaigns. So these are the groups that are dedicated to raise funds and spend funds for campaigns and elections only, right? And there are lots of political action committees out there. So simply people say PACs. And super PACs are a special type of PACs. They have this name super because basically, super PACs are not strictly regulated by the federal government. In other words, there's no limitation on the amount of money they can raise and they can spend for electioneering activities. So mainly through super PACs, we see that lots of, you know, interest groups, they try to exert influence on the outcome of elections. And so we prepared some you know, video clips that explains how super PACs actually work. Are they really, is this part of a conspiracy theory? No, right? Super PACs, they actually are very, very active, and probably you've already, you know, come across many interesting, you know, political information and advertisements online, and most of them are actually made by super PACs. So let me show you some of the examples.
You want to play the super PAC explanation first?
No, let us move on to the actual example. These are the video clips that we found recently. And this 160,000, actually you see the identity of the super PAC, America First Action Super PAC. By just looking at their identity, their name, you know that it is from the Republican Party side, right? So let us watch this.
160,000 jobs lost. It's not a statistic. It's 160,000 sleepless nights and hard conversations. Because Joe Biden supported the NAFTA deal he said wouldn't send our jobs to Mexico and backed bad trade deals with China. that shipped our jobs overseas. It's 160,000 reasons Joe Biden shouldn't be president.
So at the end of the material made by SuperPay, you can see their identity. So America First Action is responsible for the content of the advertising, paid for by America First Action, not authorized by any candidate or a candidate's committee. It's very important. Legally, it is the condition through which super PACs can spend unlimited of amount of money. If they are directly or indirectly coordinating or associated with candidates or political parties, then their activity becomes illegal. That's why it is so important for them to disclose that, hey, we are doing this independently. And here we are exercising basically our constitutional right to speak about our political views. So it is our freedom. And America is the only country that allows this unlimited free exercise of freedom of speech. If you look at other comparable nations, like many Western European countries, actually they have more restrictive campaign spending, campaign finance law, because they know there's a danger out there, right? But here in the United States, strong tradition in liberalism, which emphasizes the individual liberty. That's why we see that the campaign finance regulations are very relaxed in the United States, and we see lots of these materials. And the question here is, okay, we know that interest groups are out there and they are very actively making these kind of materials to educate the public. And then is the information provided by them is credible? It's a very good question, right? Because as long as
is responsible for the content of this advertising.
So because as long as the information is correct, then it should be less of a problem. But if the information is biased or not correct, then it could be a really big issue. And many people see that since super PACs are, you know, not under strong and restrictive surveillance of government, actually they can say whatever they want. And there is actually no way that we can clearly check whether credible or not. And one example under Super PAC, Citizens United v. FEC, so Federal Election Commission, this is the recent Supreme Court ruling that actually gives this free voice even to corporations. Corporations can be considered as individuals. Therefore, they are entitled to the First Amendment freedom. Therefore, corporations can spend millions or billions of money because that is part of their constitutional right to speak freely about their political view. And also as part of super PACs, there are some organizations that can be anonymous. So 501c organizations, so that is the tax code, okay? And if your organization is categorized as one of these organizations, then you can actually make materials and you don't have to reveal your identity. At the end of the material, you don't need to say who we are and who we work for. You don't need to say that. So that is even more risk out there. And we know that the spending of interest groups and their involvement in politics has increased tremendously over time, especially after 2000 and after the 2010, you know, Supreme Court ruling. It gives, you know, free tickets to these interest groups. So we see that. And also the media, and we know that, you know, cable channels and all these media, lots of different media outlets, they are not independent and they are somehow associated with these political groups and political parties. And many of them are actually run by these Jewish, you know, business owners and things like that. So actually the media conglomerates are really huge and they dominate the media. And many students ask me, okay, why is it that the media is too liberal, right? It is because, you know, these one of these business, you know, these media owners, they have their own political agenda and they try to, you know, indoctrinate, you know, the public in with this particular ideology. And it happens to be liberals. That's why we see more dominance of liberal ideas going on in the United States, not just here, but everywhere, I think. But interestingly, because of the rise of social media, we see that also conservative groups, they become very active and they try to convey their own information to these potential customers. And there's lots of, there's lots of research that shows that if you spend more time on social media, and if you rely on social media as the major source of political information, then actually it works negatively. You tend to have less accurate information, lack of political knowledge, even though you believe that you are exposed to this political news a lot. That's why you think that you know a lot about politics and you have a great, you know, correct ideas. But actually, no, it is the opposite, because the content that we see on social media is selectively, you know, chosen, filtered out already, right? And therefore, and it is influenced by your networks and your views, pre-existing views already. That's why you are more likely to be exposed to biased information that probably would help reinforce your existing ideas. So that is the danger. And we see that lots of, you know, adult generation particularly, they watch lots of, you know, unverified, you know, news source. They rely on unverified news sources a lot. YouTube, for example. And they believe that that is true, which is not covered by the main, you know, main media. And they're saying it is not covered, even though it's true and it is very important. It is not covered by the mainstream media. It is because the mainstream media is dominated by communists. And it is very dangerous, right? We understand why and where this idea comes from. But really, right, we should be very careful. And as he, Dongyu Kim said, you know, either liberal or conservative, this is not truth, right? The basic, the starting point is from Genesis chapter 3 and 6 and 11. How can we make the world better? We can do it. Our system can do it. So the beginning is the same. Therefore, if you say, oh, it is the only the conservative ideology and it is only the liberal ideology, no, not true, because the theories are not perfect. So that is the message that we wanted to share. So as we sum up, we wanted to share these prayer topics for the nation. I think these are very important. So first, for the unity of the people under the light of the truth, which is Jesus Christ. It is not liberal or conservative, right?
Amen.
And because lots of people, particularly believers, many people support the Republican Party because of the social policy, you know, positions that they are taking. They are more godly, that's for sure, because they are, you know, position is more in line with the Bible, that's true. But is it the solution then? I'm not sure, because Satan always tries to divide the people and try to make certain issue more politicized. And if an issue becomes more politicized, then the reaction from the other camp becomes stronger. So it's very hard. So should we really say, oh, we should do this because it is godly? I don't think that is wise. We need leaders who are really wise and guided by the Holy Spirit, so that who can make decisions that are pleasing to God and are in line with the gospel, but still at the same time, you know, it doesn't, you know, their decisions do not divide the country and do not politicize or radicalize any issues. So we really need leaders who are like Daniel or Joseph, because these people, you know, they were wise and they made decisions guided by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, whatever they did not make things controversial at all. Everyone agreed and everyone thought that, wow, their decisions make sense and they make the right decisions. We need leaders who are filled with the Holy Spirit so that they can do the same. And the leaders with the spiritual power so that Satan's schemes and works would be bound and broken down. So whatever they have in their, you know, in their mind, you know, does not be revealed to Satan and the whole world, but, you know, wisely they can proceed toward the godly side so that, you know, the decisions, the policies that they make will heal the nation and will heal the people. and the spirit, you know, stop the spiritual, you know, problems. Thank you.
Thank you for your time. If you have questions, just let us know.
Amen. Thank you. It was so relevant to today's message about the culture content of Exodus. It was just directly in line. And the minority, the prayer topic is the minority of the gospel culture. It was at this time the minority who really had not just the gospel, but with the gospel culture, they were able to change the age. Rather than what you should do, you have to know something. What do they have? They were able to have the culture to save no matter where they were. So I think it was very relevant that we people of the gospel and someone in the politics field be able to change the spiritual feel, spiritual flow, and have the gospel culture flow into that field. So thank you so much. Does anybody have questions?
I do have a question. I'm not sure I can ask this question to you since you are a professor in Texas, very red state. But are you going to vote? And also, are you registered in a certain party? Is that possible? Can you reveal?
We are a permanent resident. We don't have a party. We try to be neutral for my students, and that's helping us. We're neutral, very neutral. We don't have any political affiliation. Try to be very neutral.
Okay, thank you.
I think it was relevant to all nations are watching the elections of the United States. I was just talking to leaders in Singapore, Korea, and Vietnam, and they are all watching the debates, even more so than the U.S., the people in the U.S. So all people around the world are actually eyeing because it affects the culture, and their decisions of their businesses and society. And so it's very relevant and it's important for us to also pray. Does anybody have questions? Mm-hmm. Comment?
I have one question. Other person can go. Mm-hmm.
Luke?
Oh, yep. It was just me? Okay, my bad. Is there anything special about this particular election that you think is an anomaly compared to the previous, most recent ones, like the past few years or the past few elections?
Anomalies. Lots of things, actually. Lots of things are anomalous. One thing that just come to my mind, it's the lack of platform on the Republican side. The platform is really important in American politics because government runs not just by the president. The Congress also have a huge role, and the Supreme Court also has a huge voice on lots of matters. So the power is divided into three branches, right? But the party platform is important because it provides a guideline for the congressmen. A lot of Congress to follow in lots of different bills, but Republican in this convention, they didn't adopt any platform. That's super anomalous. The Mitch McConnell, the Senate Majority Leader, he said what he did as a president of the United States is the platform. What he will do, we support fully. That's what he said. I don't know. That's very anomalous, I would say, and a little bit dangerous, I think. The party platform has been abolished on the Republican side, And all the congressmen is basically looking at one person for a lot of different policies, right? That's, to me, that's very odd. Yeah, we can add.
And also, particularly this year, it really shows me that the competition between the two parties is more centered around the clash of culture or civilizations. So it is all about culture and cultural identities. So immigration is a perfect example. And it is, between immigrants versus, native born US citizens. But yeah, right. So us and them, and that identity matters a lot. And for us, since we are, Korean, and when we teach American politics, we should be extra careful about, when we talk about immigration policies, right? Because of course we try to remain neutral, but when we say something that kind of contains a negative connotation, about Trump administration's immigration policies and things like that, then there, some of the students' reaction would be, you are saying that because you are foreigners. You don't know us. You are not part of our country. So it is, very sensitive. And now that this issue becomes very important, very prominent, as a continuation from the 2016 election, and now it's still there. And also religion, right? So the Trump administration knows its support base, right? They try to mobilize, these Christian communities so they can really appeal to this group. And, that is true, right? But still, I don't think the previous elections or any other previous candidates, emphasized and politicized that cultural element that directly. I've never seen any candidates who directly emphasize that as us versus them. That frame is very, very strong in regards to this cultural dimension as well. So everything tried to divide us between us and them. That tendency is very, very strong starting from the 2016 election. And I think that will get stronger, in the meantime, I think. So that is one anomalous thing, because now we see these clashes between cultures and identities. It is not only here, but in Europe as well. Immigration becomes a huge issue, and it is related to religion, right? And belief systems. So it happens everywhere else, but particularly under the Trump administration, it's very, very, it becomes very prominent. Do you want to add anything?
No. I do have two more questions. Do we have a time? I will be quick.
Lydia, hold on. We have next. We have Izzy from Chile.
Yeah, it was more like a comment than a question. I'm also coming from political science, and I've been trying to make both worlds come together with spirituality. And I feel like as humans, we also have the swing states. There are hard believers, and you have non-believers, and there are people that are in the middle from both sides that can always swing. And that's why framing is so relevant, and the content is so important of how we go out to the field. And during today's message, Pastor was saying that the three organizations were giving the people what they want. And I don't completely disagree with that, but I believe that they are giving people what they think they want, and they are reinforcing that belief in them, that is what they want. But that is not true. The reality is that they don't know what they want. And that's what fundamentally it's needed. And because we do know that, we have such a relevant role, not only within spirituality, but also how we go out into the field when it comes to politics. And yeah, all the roles politicians play.
Thank you. I was also reminded of the scripture, Matthew 5:9, the unconventional thought, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. So thank you for sharing that comment. And we'll have Kite, and then we'll have Lydia share after Kite. And if you have more,
I was just curious, my question is, how, to what extent are Christians should be involved in politics? Let me rephrase that actually. For instance, like in California, government Newsom kind of like banned from like church meetings and like singing hymns and things like that. And I personally believe that because of those people in the history who have fought for our liberty and our religious freedom, that we are here able to worship freely. But at the same time, I'm also hearing from the other side saying that Christians, we are to be, we should be conflict averse. We shouldn't cause conflict. Politics is not for, I guess, Christians, is like actually what I'm hearing also at the same time. So I was curious, as Christian, like what should be our, what do you think about that?
That's a good question. Good questions. Well, I think that's my question too, a little bit, right? But I believe, I truly believe our mission, is to leave the world with the gospel, with a mission, right? Maybe sometimes outrightly spoken or hidden, either way. I think there's no like a firm answer to that question. I think it's up to individuals. And it's a hard question. What do you think?
I think, to what extent? I honestly don't know, but I don't think, you know, we need to just stay outside of politics. I don't think that is also an answer. I don't think so. Because politics is very important. We know that, right? And we just let unbelievers and the world decide everything, and we are just behind the scene and we just pray for. I don't think that is not an answer either. So I don't know to what extent we also need to figure out to what extent. But relating to this, I always thought, okay, Pastor Ryu and our messages, through our messages, we hear that, okay, remnants, you will stand before kings, something like that. And I always question, okay, why do we have to always stand before kings? Maybe some of our remnants could be the kings. Why should we always beside the kings and be an assistant, right? We can be the kings. So I always thought, in that regards, I think to some remnants, if their vision and God called them for politics, and I think they have to be actively pursue this political career, because you just sit here and just let them decide everything, no, not good. Why don't we be involved and directly guided by the Holy Spirit, and we are directly involved in the decision making processes, and we have an opportunity to influence and try to shine the light directly to the system. I think that could also be an answer.
Amen. So if you feel like I have to make a strong voice about the politics, do it. But when you do it as a remnant.
Yes. And always remember these both sides. The both worlds are not perfect. So we need to be careful, and we need to always ask God, okay, God, what is the way that I need to take regarding this issue?
If we pray on every step we make in politics, then it shouldn't be matter. It should be okay, I think.
That's really helpful. Thank you so much.
Lydia?
Thank you. So actually, I definitely agree with EJ. And then one of my questions was what Kite say, because I think that's very important. And especially my church, we our pastor actually say we need to pray about Trump. You know, he's a very strong supporter for the Trump. Mm. And we are, he's an immigrant, and then I'm also too, as American, Korean American. But then the only reason is a few of the things about the gay right, and then Trump appointing the Supreme Court, and then just those the thing. We are just supporting the Republican, not we, but our pastor. So that was actually my one of my questions that what did they say as a Christian, especially in here US, where should, how we should be, you know, stand, and then how we, how much we should be involved, and how can we say, and that what you say was very important. One my question is, I actually pray for next generation, future generation. I believe that one remnant will be raised, and then we will become the president. I really pray for that. So is there, I mean, I'm not in this field, you are the expert. Is there something, your special prayer topic in that, your region, I mean, your field? And I think we cannot really entirely change the entire political and then system to shine the light of gospel. But then I think having one remnant and really going through that field and they're revealing everything with the standard of the gospel, I think that's very important. So do you have any special, I want to know too, what are your prayer topic in your field? And then any comment you want to share anything about the my prayer topic about the praying for the remnant president of the US? Thank you.
So thank you. Thank you so much, Lydia. For my personal prayer topics in my field, I have two things. First, as a political science professor, I am a member of academia. So I always pray that I can find the hidden disciples in my field so that I can raise the army of political scientists. That's a very huge prayer topic, but I always pray. And it's been 5 years into the academia. God has opened up lots of opportunities to a lot of people, especially the Hispanic population. So that's one of my personal prayer topic. For the nation, I pray that my wife, Dr. Mi-Sun Kim said, we strongly believe in the next generation or so, we will see our remnants becoming the kings. So if Kamala Harris will be the next vice president, then she will be the first African-American, right, the minority woman in the high office. There has been a couple of attempts for the minorities to become the high office, become a president or vice president. I think those time will come soon. And then maybe next times, maybe our remnants, right? Regardless of the race or gender or whatever, I pray our remnants, one of our remnants will become the king. And then I truly pray that I don't believe we can dramatically change, revolutionize the political system we have. That by design, it is extremely difficult to change anything. But I pray the remnant, who become the king, he will opens up the way for the political system to share or the shine the light of Jesus Christ. Right, in an age of church destructions, in the age of church closures, she will use his political authority to help churches, to build the churches. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so for wonderful questions and comments. The scripture that I was also reminded was, don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Amen. Spirit dwells in your midst, 1 Corinthians 3:16. So one remnant entering a political field is one church entering the field. And there's mighty nations and the Israel has spiritual problems, the mighty nations has spiritual problems, but the word of God is the only answer to that problem. And that is why God has given us this blueprint And it is very, and we are very thankful to see a disciple raised up so that a worldview, a different worldview, a different reality, who has a different reality, who sees a politics field in a different reality, be able to interpret that for the future generation. So thank you so much for sharing this. And we were also reminded that the summit culture, the prayer culture, and the masterpiece culture are the answers that God has already given to us and we could enjoy. Thank you for this wonderful time. And thank you for changing the spiritual flow. And this is the culture. This gospel culture is the culture that will survive. And we pray that this gospel culture penetrate into all nations and also all fields of the United States. So now we see which states have what type of political view. We know our evangelism field. God has opened up that field, and also God has given us the culture content of Exodus. So I will stretch out my hand and strike the Egyptians with all the wonders that I will perform among them. After that, he will let you go. So God has given us the name of Christ, the true king who crushed the head of the devil, head of the Satan, and he's a true priest who forgave all our sins, and he's a true prophet who made the way to meet God. So let us hold on to that absolute covenant of Jesus Christ and answer to all problems. So let us pray for that, and let us pray for the nation and the culture, the culture of this nation be altered into the gospel culture. And also finally, let us pray for Professor Dongkyu Kim and so Professor Mi-sun Kim to raise the banners in the politics field for future generations. Let us pray, and we're gonna end in the prayer that Lord has taught us. Open up your mics and please pray. Father, we come to Jesus is the Christ. You have given a culture
as the light and soul to this world
that will save.
Lord, help us to not lose the light, to not lose the saltiness,
to all the
people to really go out in our fields and create this field of
financial
plots, so that this country
education is only
the reward. What this country needs the most, not the White House, not anything else. You, Lord, Jesus Christ, the gospel.
To the gospel of the Christ.
May the love and the grace and the power of Jesus Christ be upon every single person. May
they become. And at this time,
in the coming election, may your will be done, and may your kingdom come upon this earth. And we believe that you have a perfect plan. May things be done under your absolute sovereignty.
You watch over the election, and also we pray that all the forces of darkness crumble down. May the churches continue to be
filled
in this nation. May you open up the door to evangelism in the
country
of United States.
This country, so that we can repent and come back to
individuals who are
please heal this land.
Give grace to the
through politics. May the kings
are, who do not
remnants who come kings and the
kings, pray this in Jesus Christ.
And before kings come,
her Father who art in heaven,
Lord in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy
will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us
this day our daily bread.
Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors.
Lead us not into temptation, deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Everyone have a wonderful day and remnant day. Enjoy gospel and pray for a nation.
Thanks, then.
감사합니다.
You too.
감사합니다. 감사합니다.